King Mod, Peter Meerdon, The Who and the Making of a Subculture. In 75, author Steve Turner interviewed Peter Meerdon, the man who discovered The Who. A small part of the interview was published in the NME during 1979, a year after Meerdon's death, and was instrumental in the first major revival of mod culture in the UK. The full interview has never been published before until now. And not only that, but it's not only what Meerdon says, it's the way he says it. Delighted to say that joining me live on the line is the author of King Mod. Steve Turner. Steve, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
Good to have you with us. Give us a little bit of background about yourself and how you bumped, because people won't know. They'll know the culture, and if they're of my generation, they'll have come across the second inclination, you know, which was the jam, etc. But explain a little bit about who Peter Meerdon was.
Peter Meerdon was a guy who he discovered The Who, and he at the same time he was a pioneer mod, and he was attending the Scene Club in Ham Yard, just near Piccadilly Circus, where all the latest mod fashions and music trends began in the early 60s. And he fancied having a group that he could turn into mods who would somehow articulate the way mods felt and also play the kind of music that mods liked. I think he had worked with Andrew Oldham, and I think he was inspired by what Andrew Oldham had done when he took over managing the Stones. And Andrew Oldham said on the back of one of the Stones albums that the Stones are not just it's not just music, it's a way of life. So I think Peter got that idea that you could sell bands as a way of life, not just a sort of musical outfit. And it carried on in the 70s with people like the Sex Pistols, who were definitely a way of life as well as music.
that's a way of putting it. But the thing with mods as well is, if you look at disposable income that young people have in the late 50s, early 60s, you've got the Teddy Boys, you've got the Greasers and the Bikers and that whole Sweet Gene Vincent situation. But the, you know, mod is, it's not pop. It's trying to be grown up music. You know, it's teenagers or early 20s, but there's a style to it, isn't there? They're not teeny boppers. It's something that sort of young men can aspire to, and young women looking sharp, as opposed to having a leather and being on your Triumph.
Yeah, it was a kind of a subtle thing, because if you were a mod, you would recognize another mod by like the way they had the parting in the hair, or, you know, just sort of subtle things about your hair and your suit, you know, the number of vents you had and the size of the pockets and whether you had flaps or not. And these things changed month by month. There was an interview in a magazine called Town. They weren't calling themselves mods then, but they were calling themselves stylists. And they did a report, and one of the mods, well, stylists that they encountered was Mark Bolan, who later made his name with T-Rex. And apparently, they took these photographs, and when the magazine came out, which would have been 2 or 3 months after the interview, Bolan was horrified at the clothes he was wearing back then, you know, like 3 months before. Things were just changing so quickly. And mods were all about setting trends and sort of keeping on the move all the time.
It's interesting, isn't it, as well, because, you know, you think about, you know, the importing of Lambrettas and the Vespas, etc., and that look in the cafe culture. But they also, I mean, it wasn't where perhaps Neuromantics was, you know, look at me and my how beautiful I am. I mean, they did party, and they did, you know, did enjoy a fight now and again, because it was a fuel. Should we say it was a fueled atmosphere?
Yeah, they were. A lot of them were like really working class, and people like Pete Meerdon were sort of from working class families. They went to grammar school. They were very bright, but they didn't like the kind of academic life. They were bright in a way that schools couldn't really cope with. So Peter was into sort of James Bond and Mickey Spillane novels and French fashions and French film and Italian. You know, it was a whole mix of new exciting things. And I guess the thing about mod, which is different to rockers, was like if you were a rocker, you couldn't work in a bank wearing a leather jacket with chains on and studs and things like that. But you could work in a bank wearing a nice suit that you'd spent a lot of money on and had it sort of made to measure. But it was just very subtle, because your lapels would be slightly different to the manager's, and your hair would be slightly different to the manager's.
So there was
you know, it was kind of style that was not instantly observable to people that weren't in the know. So the parents probably thought, oh, he's really smart now. You know, he's wearing a suit and a tie and his hair's pretty short. But it was a lot of other kind of messages were going on.
Interesting. It was hiding in plain sight. So how does he come across the Who? I mean, I love the Who, but you just mentioned Mark Bolan. He changed fashion like you wouldn't believe, because he then became the Metal Guru, didn't he? The 20th century boy. But you see how they change their styles. So we meet the Maximum R&B, and then they are mods, and then they're at Woodstock, and then they are perforating eardrums between here and Leeds, and they keep reinventing themselves. So presumably, if you're looking for a band who are great live and can be moulded a bit, then the Who rather than the Kinks were it? I mean, how does he come across them?
Well, I think they were pretty rough-edged when Peter met them. I mean, they'd originally been called the Detours, and they wore sort of smart jackets and ties, and they were playing sort of Beatles music and Beach Boys songs and things like that. They didn't really have a definitive style. But Peter, there was a guy called Guy Stevens who was doing DJing down at the Scene Club, and Peter took the band round to Guy Stevens. Guy Stevens kind of played them loads of music, like from Sue Records in the States and all the obscure stuff and obscure B-sides. Then he made a tape up for them, and this was their kind of apprenticeship, really. And then Peter Meaden took them all out and bought them cycling jackets and Levi's with turn-ups and boxing boots and all that stuff, and said, now you're mods, you're playing mod music and you're mods. And then he wrote their first single, which was called I'm the Face. And he didn't like the name Who, so he called them the High Numbers. So their first single was as the High Numbers, and it was called I Am the Face. And that was, Peter did the lyrics.
Okay.
And there was a song called Zoot Suit that was on the B-side, and that also was written by Peter. So he was in sort of total control for a few months. And then Kit Lambert and Chris Stamp took the Who over, and as Roger Daltrey said to me, they basically took Pete Meaden's ideas and made them bigger. And they were much more together and much more accomplished than Peter was. Lambert was a son of a classical composer.
Yeah.
And Stamp was Terry Stamp's brother. And they knew how to handle money and everything.
And yeah, it's interesting, talking about Face, because obviously we then have, Small Faces. Kenny Jones is in the Small Faces. He will eventually take over and play The Who.
Yeah, and funnily enough, Peter Meaden had a hand in a group called The Moments, which the singer was Steve Marriott. And he took them to Carnaby Street and to John Stevens and got them all kitted in the dress jackets and, the latest shoes and trousers. So that was kind of almost like his trial run before he got hold of The Who and turned them into something. Then after The Who, when he lost The Who, he took over Jimmy James and the Vagabonds, which were like a black, basically Jamaican guys living in London, playing soul music, American soul music. So that was his next attempt to sort of catch the mod market.
And I mean, did they, because he was King Mod, obviously, when he rocks up with The Who with this different look, which is slightly different from everything that everybody else is wearing, presumably, because he had influence, they were like, okay, yeah, we will, rather than having, they were, if you like, introduced to the crowd, but the crowd said, yeah, we like that look, rather than somebody saying, this is the look you're going to have, and it being totally rejected.
Yeah, they were, I think John Entwistle and John Entwistle, Roger Daltrey and Keith Moon were not as keen on the mod thing as Peter. Peter Townsend had been to art college, and he understood light imagery, and he kind of related immediately to this thing about the mods. The others less so, but they went along with it, They could see that it made sense. But Pete really got into the mod mindset. He talked to these kids in Shepherd's Bush and at the Scene Club, and the early songs like Anyway, Anyhow, Anywhere, and I Can't Explain, and even Substitute, definitely My Generation.
Yeah.
They really like what the mods would have said if they could have said it, if they had the ability to articulate themselves in that way. I mean, I can't remember hearing My Generation at the time. It was just a statement song, He just went, wow, yeah.
And also,
that's exactly how you felt at that age,
I mean, it's particularly British. I mean, I know it goes around the world, but it's a particularly British thing, isn't it? And if you like, because Townsend writes with that suburban sort of British type of like the Kinks do, and so it absolutely I mean, you can't really imagine. I mean, second time round, the Americans get this sort of strange mod Fred Perry, and the less said about that, the better. But, you know, yeah. It's a particularly British phenomenon, and if you like, with the mods that first time round, and a sort of southeast look, is that fair to say?
The only group I can think of that did something similar in a way was the Beach Boys with the Surfers in California. You know, where you had a music that kind of matched the mood of surfing. But generally, in Britain, we tend to encourage eccentric. You know, we love our eccentrics, and we, you know, for me from a kid, I remember, you know, seeing Teddy Boys and stuff like that, and it becomes kind of part of your life. They're these fascinating people, and then they die out, and a new group emerges. It was a fascinating period. I don't know if it exists so much now, because you wouldn't be headline grabbing now. I mean, you could put a bolt through your head and it wouldn't be headline grabbing. But then, you know, having greasy hair on trailed on your shirt collar was, you know, people would nudge each other and say, well, look at that.
Yeah, because walking down a high street, because obviously now everybody's on TikTok and social media, so you do that, it's around the world in 30 seconds. But, I mean, if you went to Carnaby Street, which is quite, you know, which fell out of favour and became a tourist attraction in the early 80s, there'd be like these punks who weren't really punks walking around posing for pictures for Japanese tourists, you know.
That's right. Yeah, news travelled very slowly. I mean, I grew up in the Midlands, so I sort of caught the mob thing after it had become the front page news, when there were the fights in Clacton and Brighton and places like that. So I was well behind the curve, because Pete had been into it from like 62 onwards, and even he was a bit too old to be a mod. I mean, I saw the figures for when they raided the Scene Club in 64, I think it was, and the average age is something like about 18 of the kids down there. Peter was about 23 by that time.
But you need to be that age to party and do whatever you're doing, and then be able to get up in the morning and function. You know, you need a metabolism like a cheetah. I mean, if we were to try it now, we'd need major surgery, wouldn't we?
He was taking a lot of amphetamines, and but he would stay up all weekend, basically, and then Sunday morning you'd try and catch a ride back home. Mm. But they're up all night.
What was the situation?
Hospital so Friday.
what was the situation then that led to sort of you meeting up with him in 75? And was he regretful? Was he wistful? Was he still? I mean, how was he?
Okay, well, I was writing about rock music. I'd been the editor of a magazine called Beat Instrumental. That's where I first met Pete Townsend, and I was there when I first saw The Who. And I was then freelancing, and I was at Ronnie Scott's at some press launch. The kid used to have press parties at the Ronnie Scott's Club in Frith Street all the time. And I got into a conversation with a guy who was from Leeds Music, and he said, we're doing a deluxe songbook for The Who called A Decade of The Who, and it's going to have paintings in it. And he said, would you like to be the writer? We're going to have sort of stories threading through it. And I took that on, and I'd heard of Peter Meaden, and I thought it would be great to track him down. And I wrote him through the publishers of I Am The Face, because I knew that, you know, he'd be getting some money somehow, and they'd be in touch with him. And they must have, I think they supplied me with a number, and I called, and somebody, I said, it's Peter Meaden, and I said, oh, hold on, he's on M1. And I thought, it must be a motorway service station or something. But it was a mental hospital. He'd checked into a mental hospital. But he was happy to talk, and he came around to my flat, and we did the first long interview at my flat in the West End. And then a few days later, or a week later, I went to the hospital and interviewed him there. And he was a bit regretful. He still was. You can see in the interview, or you can read in the interview, where he gets a little bit agitated. And you know, the Who were my mates. They were my mates, and he seemed to place more importance on the fact that they were his mates than anything else, and losing his mates was quite a blow. And the guy called Tony Hall, who was quite well known in the music business, apparently called him a pilled-up mod, and he took a bit of a dislike to that.
Right.
So there was a slight edge of resentment. And I think there was quite a pride in what he'd done, and the fact that I was interested in him, and I was quite willing to sit there and listen to his stories.
Because if you think of what happens with...
in the introduction, it was the way he conveyed the information about the mod movement that was as exciting as what he was describing. I mean, you could have somebody tell the same stories, but in a rather dry way. It wouldn't be as exciting. But Peter was his mind was like going down a rabbit warren all the time. Different, he'd use a phrase from a song, and that would remind him of something else, and that would remind him of bullfighting, and that would remind him of something else. And off he went.
I mean, because he's got this. I mean, there are all these quotes. I mean, it is like sitting at the feet of the Dalai Lama of mod, isn't it? I mean, yeah. You know, it's, for example, when you're a mod, you want things tailor made. The jacket has to be tailor made. The shoes have to be just right. Everything has to be just right. It's the detail. It's like custom built. And then you shoot the man if his shoulder pads are wrong. You know, you don't just go back. You don't even accept the jacket. You look at him and you feel ill because he's done something wrong.
That's right.
It is those little details, isn't it?
Well, he said to me, mod is an aphorism for clean living under difficult circumstances. I mean, it's just part of the conversation, but that's become the title of mod compilation albums. You can get it on T-shirts and everything. It's become a, like, you know, blessed are the poor in spirit or something like that. It's one of those sayings that's gone down in history.
It's interesting you mentioned Andrew Long Oldham, because obviously he was with the Stones up until what, 66, I think it was, and then it got too much.
He went to form Immediate Records, yeah.
Yeah, and then of course, and you think of what happens with obviously the Who and Bill Kerbishley muscles, or, you know, comes in, doesn't it? So, well, Kit comes in and Kerbishley takes over later on as well.
So that's right, yeah. Well, Andrew, fortunately, wrote the foreword to my book, which is nice, and he was very adulatory about Peter Meaden, and he basically says he gave me a life, which is quite a thing to say. I think Andrew was more together than, was as interested in clothes and the whole thing as Peter Meaden, but he was much more together, and Peter was known for sort of being very frenetic, and then you'd see him one day, and then you wouldn't see him for 2 days, and you didn't know where he'd gone. You know, he was not very trustworthy.
Yeah, but also, if you think about it, I mean, you think how sharp the Who become as business operators, and you think how absolutely sharp the Stones were after they got them with Jagger and everything. So perhaps it is a story. Yeah. You know, the idealistic goes out of the way as they become more and more well known, and they realise that, you know, people get used to a certain stage and then no further.
Yeah, I think these bands like the Who, the Beatles, the Stones, they've got at least one member who's got their head together and are creative. But, I mean, Paul McCartney's like the real sort of stable centre of the Beatles, the one thinking about the future, the one not wanting to upset the press or the public. And Mick Jagger with his sort of, I don't know, he got his degree in economics, but he knows all about money and marketing and everything like that. So somebody, I think it was Craig Brown, you know, the columnist, he said, like, if there'd been two Keith Richards in the Stones and no Mick Jagger, you know, you wouldn't have the Stones as they are, because to have a crazy, lazy guy, you also need a guy who's hardworking and to count.
And obviously with the Who, you've got Townsend and you've got Daltrey, who...
Yeah. You know. Very, very different people. And Pete's incredibly creative, and I think he keeps going back to that mod era in a way. It's funny because I didn't realise, but that Tommy's just opened on Broadway again.
You know, oh, wow.
And so there's all these interviews with the big talk shows in America were coming up on YouTube, and so Pete's sort of plundering his own past in a way, you know, recycling it.
Yeah, but I mean, I suppose it's an appreciation of stuff that was perhaps a little addled at the time, you know, all that sort of the rock opera stuff, and people are getting back because people are rediscovering vinyl and etc. And there's even talk of a prog revival. Yeah. Shudder. So they, what's it like listening? What was it like listening back to those, you know, the full interview again, and also speaking, you know, taking the book onto that second wave where, you know, A Bomb on Wardour Street, David Watts, which is the first single I ever bought with my own pocket money, and all right. That, you know, that second mod revival.
Okay. Well, listening to the interview again was great because I'd had it all transcribed, but I thought I'd better go through it again myself and transcribe it because I actually had somebody else transcribe it the first time around, and, you know, I thought there might be mistakes or they might have jumped over something. So I did it all again. Sorry, what was your question?
just wondering what it's like to A, look at, to put the interview out in full, and okay. B, also, because obviously the impacts it's made, speaking to some of the people who were still around, obviously, and also that, you know, because that leads to the, if you like, the second mod revolution in, what, 78, 77, 78?
Well, what I did was, I mean, the interview is pretty substantial. I can't think, oh, I should have asked him that. I should have asked him something else, because there's quite a lot of hours of material there. But to make it into a book, I've sandwiched it in between a mini biography of Peter, you know, stuff that he didn't talk about. So I traced, you know, his family, other relatives, people he'd worked with, and got their side of the story. And I saw his, I mean, he died in 1978 of a drug overdose and alcohol. And I saw the coroner's report and psychiatric reports and everything. So I was able to incorporate that. Then we got the interview. And then at the end, I do a sort of a postscript, and I talk a bit about my relationship with Peter, because I knew him from 75, the time I did the interview, to 78 when he died. I went to his funeral. So, I mean, I went to see the Sex Pistols with Peter at the 100 Club in Oxford Street, and...
Did you stay for the full effect, or leave at half-time going...
Oh, yeah, I loved it. He loved it too, but he was not in a frame of mind to want to manage a punk band. He was managing Steve Gibbons' band, who were completely different to punk. You know, they were like Bob Dylan meets Elvis Presley or something, so... That was where his heart was musically at that point. Whereas Guy Stevens, who was the Scene Club DJ and about the same age as Peter, he went on to produce London Calling for The Clash. So he could identify with the mod thing. Peter identified with the Pistols. I mean, he could see what was happening. It was a bit like... I mean, I felt this is what it must have been like to see the Who in Shepherd's Bush in 1964 or 1963 or something. And Peter agreed, yeah, that's what it was like.
Just the raw...
You felt that something was happening, you know. Like, I remember seeing David Bowie the first time I saw him in a small theatre in Harlow, and he was doing the first Ziggy stuff. I thought, you know, this is just so different. Something's happening, you know.
It's interesting, but obviously because that punk... That particular punk thing as well happening in London, because everybody in the world claims to be at the one in Manchester, don't they? That's the big Sex Pistols gig where there were about like 8,000 people there, Mick Hucknall to Tony Wilson from Factory and everything else. But you must have seen that and thought, or Peter must have seen that and thought, well, this is kind of the same energy that was going through the mod scene in, like, yeah, you know, 15 or 16 years before.
Absolutely, yeah, I think so. The Pistols were sort of enacting and dressing like the kids that you saw in the audience. And it was very much the same sort of feeling. And I always thought, I don't know how much Malcolm McLaren gleaned from Peter Meaden, but I'm pretty sure he wouldn't have been unaware of them.
Yeah.
It was a similar exercise.
Exactly. I mean,
they were guys that hung around these clothes shops in the World's End. And so he had the idea, the name Sex Pistols, the idea of forming a group, and then he just found these guys who happened to fit the bill.
And the rest, as they say, is, you know, proverbial, you know, 15 minutes of fame, etc.
The mod revival thing, I don't quite understand, in the sense that mod was always looking forward, you know, like, if you're 2 months out of date, you're out of date. But it seemed to be the opposite of a spirit of a revival.
Yeah, it wasn't really... It's an interesting one, because you can argue it's just, again, it's because you've got new, you've got sort of, you've got punk, and that implodes in itself. Then you've got new wave, if you like, coming over from CBGBs with, you know, Blondie, Talking Heads, etc. Yeah. And everybody talked about a mod revival. Okay, so you had The Jam and, to a certain extent, Madness, but Madness were influenced by Ska. You could say they're a Ska group. And then, of course, you get the Ska revival, which is basically The Beat, Selector, because it all becomes sort of... It's quite an easy thing to mash everything all together again. And I've spoken to Daniel about his book about the two-tone thing, but that was a different experience to the mod experience. But Jam just went on down that way on their own, didn't they, really?
Yeah, he's still doing it, isn't he? Still flying the mod flag.
Well, but again, I mean, you can say that Marriott's sort of is flying the Marriott flag, because he's gone down that hole, which, you know, if Marriott was still, you know, there's so much humble pie in Wildwood and all that sort of stuff that you go, oh, okay, I know where that's coming from.
Right.
What do you hope, finally, that people will take from your book?
One of the reasons I wanted to do is I thought it was a document that deserves to be put on a plinth in some way. You know, if you want to know about mod, if you want to know about that period, then here's the book, you know. It's got a lot of illustrations. I think it's 70 or 80 photographs, something like that. I think it's almost 80 photographs. There was a book that came out in the early 70s. Jan Wenner from Rolling Stone interviewed John Lennon, and he put it out as a book called Lennon Remembers.
Mm-hmm.
And it had the question-answer interview on one side and then a photograph on the other side that illustrated what was being talked about on the left-hand page. And that was the kind of style I wanted to follow. So I'm hoping it's... I mean, I don't get copies till next week, but I hope it's as good as it looked on screen. You know,
according to the notes I've got, they say 86 pages of photos, so that can't be bad.
That's right. Well, I wrote that, so yeah.
Well, they're four.
Gotta be right.
If people want to find out more information about the book, all the other stuff you're doing, because you've got, what is it? I'm going to get this wrong. Is it Hydrogen Jukebox or?
Oh, Hydrogen Jukebox is a book I'm working on about the Beat Generation and their impact on rock music, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have a website, but Red Planet do, and it's redplanetmusicbooks.com, redplanetmusicbooks.com. They specialize in music. They don't do anything but music books, so
you can
order from there, or Amazon, or
you can even order it via our own virtual bookstore. How's that? You see, so they just press a button on the TRE websites, and it's there. Listen, I'd love to get you back on to talk about a hydrogen book, Hydrogen Jukebox, when it's out, because I think we could have a lot of fun with that. But in the meantime, the book is called King Mod, the story of Peter Meaden, who many people don't have heard of, and they should do, The Who and the Birth of a British Subculture. Yeah. It's by Steve Turner, a foreword by Andrew Lug Oldham, who I'm glad he's still around. Steve Turner, it's been an absolute pleasure to speak to you today, and I'm going to play you out with a bit of My Generation. As you say, it's the finest track that they ever put out. How's that for a plan?
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Steve Turner, thank you for your time today.
Just because we get around.
Talking about my generation.
Things they do look awful.
Talking about my generation.
I hope I die before I get old.
Talking about my generation.
My generation. Take my generation, baby. Why don't you all fade away? Don't try and dig what we all say. Trying to cause a big sensation. Just talking about my generation. What we all trying to cause a big sensation. Just talking about my generation. Because we get around. Things they do look awful cold. I hope I die before I get old.